On this episode of BOBscaping, we're going to be doing some pesticide spraying and covering some of the things you should pay attention to when you're applying pesticides to your shrubs, trees, and lawn. So today we have a 1 gallon sprayer here, which is a convenient size for smaller projects. And the key with filling a sprayer is once you remove the top, first thing you want to do is fill it 1/3 of the way with water before you put any pesticides in there. Little piece of dirt will get out of there. Okay, so you fill it 1/3 of the way first with water. Being a little sloppy there this morning. Okay, then after having figured out your rate for the pesticide you're using, and most of them do have these convenient little booklets on the front, and then you should shake it well, thoroughly. The rate we need today is 2 teaspoons to this 1 gallon of water. We're going to fill the sprayer all the way. So we're going to carefully measure. It's a little more than one there, so we'll go a little less on the next one. This looks like an emulsifiable concentrate, which is kind of like a milkshake. We'll put the cap back on that so we don't knock it over, possibly spill it. Okay, so we'll rinse our spoon down in the sprayer and finish filling it. Rinse off the rest of that. Okay, got that rinsed off. Okay, these usually have a fill line on the side, and here's the one for 1 gallon. So we are there. Then you want to insert your pump. You turn that to where it's tight. And of course, when you're spraying, you should protect your skin, your eyes. Try not to inhale pesticides. If you want to play extra safe, you can wear a double canister respirator like that one, especially for larger jobs, or if there's a lot of spray mist involved. And then of course, oral poisoning is the number one killer of children with pesticides. So you want to make double sure that you never put a pesticide in a standard drink container like a milk carton or a pop bottle, something like that. You know, soda, 2-liter soda, anything like that. A child might mistake for something they can drink. So always keep pesticides in their original containers. And when you dispose of them, triple rinse them before you dispose of them. If you have old pesticides that need to be gotten rid of, there's a program in Pennsylvania called Chem Sweep, where every couple years in your county they will come around and collect old pesticides and dispose of them properly for a small fee. Okay, once the pump is on, I like to give it a little extra shake to make sure that it's pesticide is mixed up, and then you're ready to start spraying. And again, you want to have chemical resistant gloves, long sleeve shirt, shoes, long pants. You don't want to be the what I call the flip-flop gardener out there on a weekend in your flip-flops or sandals, shorts, t-shirt, no hat or eye protection. You want to protect yourself from those four routes of poisoning, which the letters ODIE, ODIE, represent. O is oral, D is dermal, I is inhalation, and E is eyes. Okay, so we'll add some more tips at the end of this video, and you're welcome to visit our webpage at donin.com to learn more about pesticides. A little trick for your gloves, since the inside will tend to get sweaty, you can see the sweat dripping out of them, is to turn them inside out like this. We'll do this one first. Turn it inside out and then take this cuff, spin it, and squeeze it and pop those fingers out. Then once the inside of that glove is dry, you can reverse it and do the same. We've gone inside into the computer classroom. You can access this same web page at the address shown on the screen. Pesticides. It's that time of year when many people are probably considering or using weed killers, insecticides, fungicides, who knows what. So this page really encapsulates all the issues about pesticides. And as we scroll down, these are hyperlinks to on down the page. There's an introduction, sprayer safety tips. There's a 800 number for the Poison Control Center. Should you consider hiring a professional to spray instead of doing it yourself? Importantly, are your children safe? Pesticide poisoning. Pesticide toxicity. Hypersensitive individuals. Some people are hypersensitive to pesticides. And then the chem sweep program that Pennsylvania uses to collect unused or old, outdated pesticides. So we'll skip through this introduction part. You can read that on your own at the web address shown. But basically, we come to a key point, which is what is known as IPM, or Integrated Pest Management. And as I've written here, public debate, university research, and practical application have landed us somewhere on the middle road with responsible pesticide usage. Instead of spray first and ask questions later, it's become the norm to practice Integrated Pest Management, or IPM. IPM has several basic tenets. Is pesticide usage really necessary, or is the level of damage acceptable? Secondly, can satisfactory control be achieved with products such as dormant oils or insecticidal soaps, since of course they are less toxic to the environment and to you? If pesticide spraying is deemed necessary, you should do these things. First, identify the affected plant. What is it, an oak, a maple? You know, what type of shrub? Secondly, identify the pest. A lot of nurseries can help you with this. If you take a sample into a nursery of the damage or the insect pest, they can help you identify it. Third, once those two are identified, use the least toxic pesticide available that is labeled for control. Fourth, timely application to when the insect is most vulnerable. Someone sent a question into the website about scale the other day, and they were talking about the recommendation to spray when the crawlers are out. Those would be the smallest ones, and sometimes the smallest or youngest stage of an insect is the most vulnerable. And finally, read and follow label directions. Very important. The most important thing an individual can do before working with a pesticide is read the label. Be sure to read the entire label, since it contains critical information concerning the proper handling and use of the product. Here's some sprayer safety tips. Keep pesticides out of the reach of children. How many labels have you seen that on? Do not use the same sprayer for weed control and insect control. Mark the sprayer you use for weeds with a marker that says weeds only, because some weed killers will adversely affect plants, especially if the sprayer hasn't been properly rinsed out. Thirdly, use a low pressure regulator to help prevent spray drift onto non-target areas. So this points out that the lower the pressure, the less chance you have of the spray drifting or floating onto non-target areas. Next, make applications in the cool of the day, especially to shrubs, trees and shrubs, early morning when there's little to no wind. So again, that gets at the point of drift, and the cool of the day, shrubs aren't as likely to be damaged by insecticidal sprays if they're sprayed in the cool of the day as opposed to like a hot afternoon. Next, spray when no rain is in the forecast for 24 hours, unless the product calls for having it watered in. It's important to dress properly. You don't want to be what I call the flip-flop gardener, which would be the person out there on a Saturday morning in sandals or flip-flops, shorts, and maybe not even wearing a t-shirt, spraying trees and shrubs, and definitely being exposed to the pesticide. You need to protect your eyes and skin, wear approved chemical-resistant gloves and boots, and wear an approved respirator if possible. One of your greatest risks with pesticides is when you're handling the concentrate. In other words, when you're getting the liquid out of the bottle or plastic container and putting it into your sprayer. So you should wear approved chemical-resistant gloves and be sure to protect your eyes from splashing. I don't know how many times I've seen a spray tank when you're dumping the pesticide into it or pouring it into it, how the water will try to splash up into your eyes. So that's a very important point. So then next is the Poison Control Center. And that's a U.S. national toll-free number, 1-800-222-1222. They're very helpful. The more information you can provide them, like having, if you have the label of the product handy, that really helps. And any other details about what's occurred. And maybe consider hiring a professional. Maybe you aren't cut out to be handling pesticides. Maybe it is too great of a risk to yourself. And are your children safe? The number one cause of pesticide poisoning in children is oral exposure. Never transfer a pesticide from its original packaging, and never put a pesticide in an old beverage container like a milk carton or an old soda 2-liter bottle or pop bottle, whatever. And definitely keep pesticides out of the reach of children and locked up if possible. Pesticide poisoning. This alludes to the flip-flop gardener. There are four routes of pesticide poisoning, and those are signified by the capital letters O, D, I, E. O would be oral, by mouth, as in the case of children. Second would be dermal. Pesticides can be absorbed through your skin, and certain areas of your skin absorb more than others. Third would be the eye, for inhalation, where you breathe in the drift or the fumes into your lungs. And fourth, the E would be for your eyes. Your eyes are very sensitive. And pesticide toxicity. There are basically three caution words or warning. Caution is the least toxic chemical pesticide. Warning is the mid-level toxicity pesticide, and the most toxic pesticides are labeled with danger poison, and usually a skull and crossbones. These are the most toxic category of pesticides, and most are only available for purchase and application by a licensed applicator. And it's always recommended to use the least toxic pesticide available to treat your particular need. Hypersensitive individuals. This is something most people don't think about, but there are individuals who are hypersensitive to pesticides. And Pennsylvania, for one, has created a pesticide hypersensitivity registry for those people to get certified by their doctors and listed in this booklet that professional lawn and tree applicators receive periodically in the mail. So if your doctor can medically certify that your name should appear in this hypersensitivity registry, you contact the address there on the screen, the Pennsylvania Department of Agriculture, Bureau of Plant Industry, 2301 North Cameron Street, Harrisburg, PA, 17110. And again, this is all on this one web page. I'll try to give you the address again at the end of the video. Chem Sweep, great program. Pennsylvania will periodically go to different counties and offer to pick up unused and outdated pesticides. And then there are a few links at the bottom of this page. And again, it's always important to read and follow label directions.